Order, order. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Mike Hill to move the motion.
Thank you, Sir Roger, and it's a pleasure to speak under your chairmanship. I beg to move that this House has considered e-petition number 242300 relating to future trade deals and the National Health Service. First, I would like to thank Mr Byron Davis for starting the petition, which to date has attracted 166,998 signatures, including over 200 from my own constituency of Hartlepool. The petition asks the government to please introduce concrete safeguards that will make sure our NHS is kept out of any future trade deals, Brexit, and is titled Don't Put Our NHS Up for Negotiation. It further goes on to say, words aren't enough. We want watertight protections that will keep our NHS off the negotiating table. Why is this important? When done well, trade deals can be good for the UK. They can help create jobs and build opportunities. But this plan would put our health service at risk. The government response was given on 17th of June 2019, and the government has been clear. The NHS is not and never will be for sale to the private sector. The government will ensure no trade agreements will ever be able to alter this fundamental fact. The Department for International Trade goes on to provide a detailed 491-word response to the petition, which can be found on the Petitions Committee website, and includes commitments such as, the NHS is not and never will be for sale to the private sector, whether overseas or domestic.
Will my humble friend give way?
Of course.
I thank my humble friend for giving way in this really crucial debate. In the light that £9 billion worth of contracts has already been submitted by the government, and in the light of the 70 section regulation 75 of the Health and Social Care Act 2012, that is the biggest threat to the NHS as it opens up the whole of the NHS to the market. Does he agree that the government must urgently repeal section 75 in order to safeguard our NHS?
My honourable friend makes a very, very powerful point, and I actually completely agree that that should be one of the things that the government ought to immediately pay attention to and do. The government will continue to ensure that decisions on how to run public services are made by UK governments, including devolved administrations, and not our trade partners. And they also say trade agreements do not prevent governments from regulating as they see fit, and they do not require governments to privatise any services. The government will ensure that nothing in our future trade agreements dilutes the powers of UK regulators to maintain the NHS's position as the best health service in the world. But, as the petitioner says, Sir Roger, words are not enough. By tomorrow, we will have a new Prime Minister. Probably, by the end of the week, we will have a new Cabinet, a new Secretary of State for Health, and possibly a new government position on these matters. And although we hear time and time again from across the benches support for the great institution the National Health Service is and for its abiding principle of being free at the point of need, these are only words without deeds. Give way.
My honourable friend for giving way and congratulating him on securing this support. I agree with my honourable friend that the previous speaker, in actual fact, Section 525 should be repealed. The government should repeal that as a matter of urgency, because essentially what would happen if we don't do that, we throw the National Health Service to the dogs, and nobody wants to do that, particularly the predators, like people like Donald Trump's administration. Would you not agree with me about that?
I agree with my honourable friend on that, and it is truly a case of words, not deeds, and I will come to that later on. So, while people may find it reassuring to hear the current Secretary of State for Health and Social Care say the NHS is not for sale and will not be on the table in any future trade talks, we cannot take his word for granted. Equally, we cannot ignore the remarks to which he was responding. They were made by the US Ambassador to Britain, Woody Johnson, in an interview with the BBC's Andrew Marr. In it, he confirmed that in a trade deal with the United States, that the whole economy, including the NHS, would be on the table. These comments were described as being terrifying by the Shadow Health Secretary, who said the ambassador's comments show that a real consequence of a no-deal Brexit, followed by a trade deal with Trump, will be our NHS up for sale. Others, like Nigel Farage, the leader of the Brexit Party, have already advocated a move away from state-funded healthcare to a more Americanised model. In 2014, he told UKIP supporters, "I think we're going to have to think about healthcare very, very differently. I think we are going to have to move to an insurance-based system of healthcare." So whatever opinions, promises or pledges are out there, it is clear that the NHS, if not for sale, must be protected and future-proofed against the outcomes of any trade agreements with the USA and any other nation state. And that, Sir Roger, is what this petition simply asks for. Of course.
I thank my old friend for giving way and support his comments about the petitioners. I'm pleased that my constituents were among the top 10 in terms of signatories to this petition. He's right to highlight the government's commitments and indeed the October 2017 White Paper on Future Trade Arrangements said that the protections of EU FTAs would continue to apply in future trade agreements. But does he agree with me that the sort of assurance that we need to give some strength to those commitments and some assurance to the petitioners is along the lines of the request of the British Medical Association that we should see the government and the minister responding to this debate by committing to putting into primary legislation a commitment that economic benefits can't take precedence over public health policy in future trade agreements?
I absolutely agree with my honourable friend. He makes a very powerful point, and the voice of the BMA and other professional bodies are most important and must be heard. The petition asks for the provision of concrete safeguards to keep NHS services out of any future trade deals. It's nothing new. It's a fight that has been ongoing for years, even within the EU. To this very day, those British members of the European Parliament who care about our NHS have been battling to keep NHS services out of the developing Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, or TTIP, between the EU and the USA. So, when the government, in response to this petition, say the UK's public services are protected by specific exemptions and reservations in EU free trade agreements, and as we leave the EU, the UK will continue to ensure that rigorous protections are included in all trade agreements it is party to, that comment can only be an aspiration. Because it is not a cast-iron guarantee that the transfer of any EU regulations into UK law will specifically protect the NHS from future trade agreements. Just as the EU have found with TTIP, so we will need to further regulate for the exclusion of NHS services from trade agreements. Action, not words, needs to be the order of the day. But with a government which in 2016 refused to exclude the NHS from TTIP negotiations, that may very well turn out to be a tall order. American healthcare providers can already compete to deliver services in the UK. However, the threat to the NHS of a US trade deal will be through clauses that lock in existing levels of privatisation and prevent future governments from rolling back.
For giving way. It's clear that the NHS is already for sale. Only recently, in my constituency, the urgent care centre was put out for tender, and it was recommended that a private for-profit company run that previous NHS facility. As has been stated, £9 billion, a record £9 billion to the private sector now. I, with my honourable friend, agree that this would be privatisation with bells on with this form of trade deal.
As always, my honourable friend makes a very powerful point, and let's not forget the millions spent in compensating those private companies who lose contracts and take our government to court as a result. So, to prevent future governments from rolling back deregulation and privatisation in the NHS, this is not only dangerous for the future of the NHS as it entrenches privatisation, but also undermines our democracy, as future governments would be shackled by the binding provisions of a trade deal. That is why some would say that the only way to fully protect our NHS from trade deals is to fully exclude it from them.
I'm grateful to my honourable friend giving way again. Thank you, Sir Roger. Also, does my honourable friend agree that the point of entryism of greatest risk to our NHS is through Big Pharma, and the way that Big Pharma will clearly make play then to run other services within our NHS, and therefore it's really essential that any trade deal also takes seriously the threats that Big Pharma pose to our NHS and the extensive drugs bill that clearly is held within the NHS?
Michael. Again, I agree with my honourable friend about her knowledge. Pharmaceuticals, as we all know, is one of the major gateways into potential privatisation of NHS services. So I say again that the only way to fully protect our NHS from trade deals is to fully exclude them from them. For me, and I am confident for the petitioners also, that is precisely what we should be doing. Thank you.
Thank my honourable friend for giving way. Does he agree with me, just on that very point, that when it comes to drug pricing, Alex Azar, the US Health and Human Services Secretary, has said Washington will use its muscle to push up drug prices abroad to lower the cost paid by patients in the United States. He says on the foreign side, we need to, through our trade negotiations and agreements, pressure them, so he said on CNBC. So what we will see, does he agree, a rise in prices within our NHS?
Undoubtedly so, and we will be hostage to fortune, and my honourable friend makes a very important point right at the end of my speech. And so again, I say I am confident for myself and for the petitioners also that these measures are precisely what we should be doing right now.
The question is that this House has considered e-petition 242300 relating to future trade deals on the National Health Service. Craig McKinley.
Thank you, Sir Roger. Just it seems to me this is a debate this afternoon on, you know, that old chestnut of public good and private bad. I mean, it has to be considered that we currently have 7.6% of all NHS spending is on what you might call private type enterprises. And they're not all just private profit enterprises. They would be community interest companies, there'd be charities, there'd be lots in the not-for-profit sector. And this is often raised as something that's sort of uniquely conservative, that we somehow want to privatise the NHS when all the facts on the additional expenditure that we've made on the NHS in the last few years is completely contrary to that. In 2010, when the Labour government left office, 4.4% of NHS spending was on that alternative, not public sector, and it's now 7.6%. The rate of growth after 2010 has been exactly the same as the rate of growth as under the Labour government. Now, the petitioners in this case, I'm sure, are fearful of, you know, what might happen in the future in terms of trade deals. That's what underlines this petition. But there was one that didn't come to pass. That was the old TTIP that the rest of Europe have decided not to pursue. I, for one, would very much welcome a future US trade deal. And I'm sure that we will be in better place to actually negotiate that than the rather sluggish way in which the EU seems to approach international trade deals. And I pay a tribute to the member for Hartlepool for actually, you know, considering that generally international trade deals are for the good. They expand investment and many more besides about international relations that I think are good. But at the time of TTIP, these same fears emerged about will our NHS be up for sale? And it was, you know, lover or loather, Cecilia Malmström, the then Trade Commissioner for the EU, made it very, very clear that NHS health services were not on the agenda in the UK or anywhere else in the EU. And we saw very similar in the CETA deal. The CETA deal, the Canadian deal, is deemed to be one of the, you know, what you might call best in class of a good free trade arrangement, obviously something that I would like to see the UK have with the EU in the future. It was an advanced trade deal. It allows for reciprocation of very many qualifications, you know, the sort of good things that I think happy, friendly trading nations can achieve. But specifically in that trade deal, and I could only envisage that we would do the same in the future with any future trade deals that the UK might make as an independent country, there was always an exemption for government-procured public services. So, and the phraseology that's used is supplied in the exercise of governmental authority. Now, that's in our hands. That's for this place to decide. And you know, this country has always been open for business. I don't know the figures. I don't know if I even use them myself. But we have very few restrictions on foreign ownership of our companies here. I don't frankly much care if there is an outsourced Indonesian company providing, you know, blood testing. What I want is the service to be done at the best possible price and the best quality to the taxpayer. And I'm sure that there are many, many services offered or paid for by the NHS today that are perhaps owned by American companies, perhaps French ones, German ones, Swedish ones. I really, really don't care too much because the importance of the NHS is that it's free at the point of delivery. I'm sure we enjoy equipment that's made internationally in very many hospitals. I'm sure, and I know that many pharmaceutical products, we have the WTO Pharmaceutical Trade Elimination Agreement, where there are very few tariffs between any of the major countries on any pharmaceutical products. So I think we should be wider than just public good, private bad in these discussions. We need some common sense. But what is remarkable, and I think this does need putting on the table, I'm sure many of the members opposite seem very, you know, they seem to want a customs union that goes on forever, perhaps single market rules that go on forever. And yet we would not have a seat at that table as the EU may negotiate future trade deals around the world and us caught up in the coattails of customs union, just as Turkey has to suffer. We could find our NHS on the table, on the back of the coattails of future EU trade arrangements with the rest of the world that we just have to follow as customs union members. Let me just finish this point, if I may, and please do come in. We would be completely powerless. And to me, that would be the worst of all worlds. Whereas at the moment, it would be our parliament, members opposite, and members on this side that would be in control of what is on offer. But please, sir.
Would the honourable member clarify how many trade deals have currently been negotiated by the government, including aspects of healthcare?
Well, trade deals today, obviously none. We're not able to, but there are many rollover agreements coming into fruition. The very biggest one just a few weeks ago by the Department for International Trade was, of course, Switzerland, which is a very major provider of both pharmaceuticals and high-level industrial equipment, often used in manufacture or in our hospitals. So they're rolling over gradually, but I want to be rather more ambitious than that. I want us to have those international trade deals that open up greater transparency and friendship and boost to trade. And if that means we start having zero tariffs on fantastic products from Japan or elsewhere, what is the problem with that? I want the service to be the best in class in this country, free at the point of delivery. And if there are UK companies able to provide and offer services internationally, well, that's got to be a good thing as well. But the decision on procurement and whether we want to open up the NHS to American or Australian or any other competition should reside in this place, not on the coattails of perpetual customs union membership, where we would have no decision-making whatsoever. Thank you. Sir Roger, I think that concludes that in the future, this should be a decision for us, for this Parliament, in consultation with the public and indeed the very good petitioners who have put their name to this discussion this afternoon. Thank you, Sir Roger.
serve under your chairmanship, and I'd like to thank my friend, the Honourable Member for Hartlepool, for introducing this debate and setting out the concerns of the petitioners who have signed for this debate. It's a very important issue, as we've heard. And I'd really like to start by picking up on the last comments that were made. It's a matter for this House to discuss what we want. And it seems to me that this House, directed by my constituents, certainly, and many others, I think, from across the House, are saying very clearly we do not want our NHS opened up to trade agreements, and we do not want it exposed to international competition. That's something that's coming across very, very clearly to me as I speak to my constituents. Whatever their views on Brexit are, frankly, everyone cares passionately about their NHS. And in my region, the North East, we care particularly passionately. We have some very good services that we treasure. And so my constituents are saying, this is not for sale. It's not negotiable. And that's, I think, the setting. But to return to my original script, Sir Roger, as the Honourable Member for Hartlepool said, words are not enough here. Earlier this year, I had the opportunity to take part in a debate on the trade bill. And this is one of the issues which came up very frequently during the debate, that constituents are telling their members of parliament that they do not want to see the NHS opened up to competition, part of a negotiation, a discussion. And I think that message came through loud and clear then. And I'm glad that people are making that statement and taking that argument forward time and time again, because we need to keep reinforcing the fact that if we're talking about trade deals, this is something which, you know, up with which we will not put, shall we put it that way. People feel very strongly about it, as I've already said. And that trade bill debate went into a great deal of detail and looked at it, and it was one of the recurring issues, as I've said. And the Secretary of State and the trade ministers who presented the debate and wound up were very keen to say that the NHS is protected. It's currently excluded, as we've heard, from EU agreements for services. So we'd want to replicate the same thing. But when we talk about Brexit, whatever happens with Brexit, when we talk about that, we're in a different situation. We're in a situation where we're having to negotiate new trade agreements and having to negotiate all the clauses and the requirements of each agreement. And that requires a hell of a lot of detail. So, and as with any agreement, any negotiation, there are two parties, at least, often more, to any negotiation. And we have our red lines, and I would say that this must be one of them. We have our red lines, but other parties will have theirs. And so we have the differing views and different negotiating agendas. And I think what the petitioners are trying to say is, this is something that we really have to stick to. And, you know, currently saying we had President Trump visit us here and make a statement about, you know, the NHS being on the table, and then, you know, did he take it off the table again? What we're clear about is it's not on the table and it must not be on the table. So we need to ensure that we do that. And the other thing is that just saying those words, as the Honourable Member for Hartlepool said, as the petitioners have said, that the NHS is not for sale, isn't the answer. Fine words, butter no parsnips, as someone once said. So what we need is we need lots of detail in all of these agreements, clearly setting out how we're going to protect our NHS in lots of different circumstances. So, for example, where some services, dentistry, for example, there are currently charges, much private work. How are we going to make sure that that's protected if it's already part of an external private sector charging? Is it a for-profit or not-for-profit? We also must make sure that where there are there's already overseas involvement in our NHS, that we're able to protect that as well. So there's a huge amount of detail, and I've no doubt that there will be a team of negotiators looking at this. But when people talk about us discussing this in the House, this is the kind of fine detail that we can't always get into. And so it's really crucial that we do get into that detail. And I think one further thing to say is we already have, as we've already heard, was it 7.3% of our NHS expenditure spent on contracting? There are many of us already think that is far too much,
and that we need to review that and make sure that we can retain our NHS services in-house. Not because it's a simple argument about public good, private bad, but because we've seen too many failures of services. And yes, there are some good examples, but there are plenty of others which are not great. So I know that people will want to look at that angle as well. So, as I said, we need much more detail. We need a much stronger debate and measures to protect our NHS. We do need those headline commitments. And those headline commitments are not just about, must not just be about having an NHS free at the point of delivery. It must be one which looks after the public and allows us to preserve our services, not just in-house in the UK, to go forward in the future. And the last thing I want to touch on really goes back to one of the first points I made, and that is about scrutiny. Again, in the trade bill, there was lots of talk about scrutiny of trade deals. And I think it's absolutely imperative that there must be an open and transparent way of scrutinising any proposals. The Honourable Member for York Central has already talked about the concerns as well about the impact on drug budgets and Big Pharma and the fear that this is seen as a ripe opportunity for prices to increase. I've just come from the main chamber where we've been talking about Batten's disease and access to medicines for and treatments for Batten's disease, and cost is one of the big pressures that means that many people sadly can't get access for the rarer diseases to medicines and treatments which would improve their lives, in some cases extend or save their lives. So there's a real concern that we may see drug prices increase in the future as well. So Sir Roger, I just want to finish by saying this is quite a simple message from the petitioners, but I think it's one that people are hearing loud and clear, and one that they would want us all to reiterate, and that is that we must protect our NHS in the context of any trade agreements. We do not want to see our NHS privatised or outsourced, even if it's by accident. We care about our NHS. We must preserve it. It's one of our great features. And I thank the petitioners for drawing our attention to this issue.
Faisal Rashid.
Thank you, Sir Roger. It's great to serve under your chairmanship, and I would like to thank Honourable Friend for Hartlepool for securing this important debate. Sir Roger, for the people in my Warrington South constituency, this issue is particularly timely. Last month, reports emerged that the Warrington and Halton Hospital NHS Foundation Trust had begun to advertise a price list for operations that were previously free on the NHS. The Trust price list offered 71 costly private operations, including vital procedures such as hip and knee replacements at over £18,000, contracts or at £2,368, and hernias at just under £8,000. The introduction of these fees was the result of Tory cuts, which are forcing the NHS to ration services that were once free at the point of use. We have consistently warned that these measures are leading to the gradual privatisation of NHS services, with vulnerable patients potentially being forced to pay extortionate fees to cover medical costs. This pricing list was the first example of an NHS trust openly advertising private medical services in this way. I was shocked to see the privatisation of our NHS advertised brazenly to my constituents, with the sick and vulnerable being exploited for profit. It was an affront to the founding principles of our NHS services. I'm pleased that as a result of pressure from myself, my colleagues and local campaign groups, the Trust decided to pause and review the scheme. But this is just a temporary victory, and there is no time for complacency. When we consider the bigger picture of our future trading relationships, there are greater battles to be fought to defend our NHS from private interests. In the same month the pricing list was published, Donald Trump was invited to the UK at the behest of this Tory government. Speaking at a joint press conference with the Prime Minister, he said the National Health Service would form part of negotiations over a possible future trade deal between the UK and United States. To use his exact words, and I quote, "When you are dealing in trade, everything is on the table." What an appalling thought that our NHS is reduced to a mere bargaining chip in negotiations. And we have seen that the Tory leadership candidates are too cowardly to stand up to Donald Trump. Last week, they refused to call his vile, bigoted attack on Ilhan Omar for what it was, racism. Not good enough. If the Tories won't stand up to Trump's racism, how can they be expected to stand up to him in trade negotiations? How can they be expected to stand up for NHS? They cannot. After he founded the NHS, Nye Bevan said of Great Britain, and I quote, "We have the moral leadership of the world. Today, it doesn't feel like this. Country has any moral leadership at all. As always, you cannot trust the Tories with our NHS. Thank you."
Stuart Hosey.
Thank you, Sir Roger. It's a pleasure to serve under your chairmanship. Can I also thank the honourable gentleman from Hartlepool for introducing this debate and speaking so well on behalf of the petitioners. I intend to start just with reference to Brexit, because I suspect much of the concerns about trade deals which may bring the NHS into play, it will actually be driven by the loss of trade associated with Brexit. And if we remind ourselves of what the UK government's long-term economic analysis said, all of the versions of Brexit analysed, the white paper, the EEA type agreement, an average free trade agreement, and no deal, all suggested that trade and GDP would be lower at the end of the forecast period than it otherwise would have been. It went on to say that all of those options, with the exception of EEA, which doesn't apply, the situation would be worse if we had net zero migration from EEA workers. So before I come on to trade specifically, it is worth pointing out that we face another challenge in terms of retention and recruitment of staff if whatever Brexit we end up with actually drives a hideous and illogical end to the free movement of people. It's also, there's a second analysis I want to draw on briefly, which was the one from the National Institute of Economic and Social Research. They suggested that depending on the type of Brexit, we could see a 22 to 30% fall in total trade. The same paper went on to suggest that a free trade agreement with the BRICS countries, all of them, and all of the main English-speaking economies, including the USA, would result in somewhere around a 6% uplift. So I suspect what government thinking will end up being, if Brexit happens, is that in order to make up some of the losses, we're going to have a quick win, a quick gain, probably with the USA, and it's hard to see for a variety of reasons why the NHS wouldn't be included in that, and I'll happily give way.
I thank the Honourable Member for giving way, and would he agree with me that it's very concerning that when the President was here on his trip to state visit to the UK, that it was the number one priority that he seemed to say, despite our own Prime Minister trying to deny that on the day.
It was concerning that his initial response is, yeah, sure, NHS, everyone's on the table. It was clawed back slightly the next day, but one does wonder whether he understood what he said the first day, or even wondered if he understood what he said the second day. I think the real concern, or the concerns out there among the public, are in fact very real indeed, for the reasons I've said, that in order to make up some trade gains from the losses which almost every single forecast suggests we'll have, it means it's hard to see how the NHS or more broad aspects of health might not be included in some kind of trade deal. I think the starting point for me is that we shouldn't be contemplating the prospect of exposing the NHS through trade deals, not least because the EU has made more trade deals than any other bloc with third countries, which we benefit from, and they've done so while protecting public services. and it makes little or no sense to throw that away. They've protected public services like the NHS in all trade negotiations. They've shown to be principled in that approach. Now, not only will we potentially lose access to those markets, but we don't have the means to replicate the agreements which we already benefit from. Now, the Honourable Gentleman mentioned the Swiss deal earlier, but of course the Swiss deal wasn't rolled over in its entirety. Indeed, a number of the reports which came out at the time said the deal risks new limits on the export of agricultural products, a possible ban on organic products, and that Switzerland may no longer recognise UK businesses as, quotes, authorised economic operators eligible for lighter controls at the Swiss border. But at the same time, a second trade deal or rollover deal was announced, which was the Norwegian one. But of course, the Norwegian one, while it did include zero duty for industrial goods, didn't include services. And the agreement described in the Norwegian press as a crisis agreement didn't cover technical regulations and rules for trade in food, animals or plants. Now, I only mention those two because what they actually do is highlight the weakness of the UK in this Brexit process. If we are not able to roll over in full with very friendly countries with whom we have very long trading relationships, then how on earth are the public expected to believe we'll be able to cut a deal with the USA to make up some of the losses from Brexit without having to sacrifice and potentially sacrifice the NHS? I'll just let the Honourable Lady intervene one moment. And it goes back to one of the things which was said to me time after time after time on my last visit to the United States. And that was fundamentally this, that the UK will be required to put everything on the table and the US will be required to put nothing on the table. And I'll give way.
The member's being very generous in giving way. Would he agree with me that one of the services' implications is the research and innovation sector? And is he as concerned as I am at the prospect that a lot of our universities and the collaborations which are done, which in effect are services, will be at risk and will take an awful long time and an awful lot of effort to replicate in a US trade deal?
I am concerned about that. I'm concerned that even now we're seeing relationships and partnerships, academic work being restricted or doubt being cast upon its continuation for those very reasons. And when that comes to the area of health improvement, then it would be tragic if the work was not done or the work was lost from some of the excellent universities who currently do and undertake those studies. But the weaknesses I speak about are where many of the concerns around the NHS lie, particularly in relation to a US-UK deal, and which drives the impression, rightly or wrongly, that the UK will be involved in some kind of ISDS, investor-state dispute resolution mechanism, which could see governments or other public bodies sued for simply protecting our health service. So I want very briefly, and I'll end with this, to give three examples to demonstrate why I think there are real concerns and where I know the public are extremely anxious. The first example is one between 1995 and 1997. The Canadian government banned the export of PCB waste, in order to comply with obligations under the Basel Convention to which the US was not a party. The waste treatment company SD Myers then sued the Canadian government for £20 million in net damages. That was under Chapter 11 of the NAFTA agreement, an ISDS-type arbitration scheme. That claim was upheld by NAFTA, even though Canada had taken action to remain in compliance with an international treaty. The second case, in 1997, the Canadian Parliament again banned the import and transport of the petrol additive MMP, over concerns that it posed a significant public health risk. Ethyl Corporation, the additives manufacturer, sued the Canadian government, again under NAFTA Chapter 11, for $251 million to cover losses resulting from what they called the expropriation of its plant and its good reputation. That was also upheld by the Canadian Dispute Settlement Panel, and the Canadian government repealed the ban and paid the corporation $15 million in damages or in compensation. Cases that involved in toxic PCB waste and a petrol additive, which was deemed to have a public health impact, were overturned. Now, I think it's quite wrong for any corporation to be able to sue governments simply for taking steps to protect the well-being of its citizens. And I use these two examples on purpose, because they may not have a direct clinical NHS procurement characteristic, but no one can be in any doubt they were public health measures which were overturned as a result of a trade deal which allowed private investors to do certain things. The second or the final example I wish to use is a lot more local. Some time ago in Scotland, we had an increasing prevalence of hospital-acquired infection. One of the actions which the Scottish Government took was to remove private cleaners and return cleaning to NHS staff. Lo and behold, the incidence of hospital-acquired infection reduced, and reduced dramatically. It does not take an enormous leap of the imagination for a non-core work like cleaning to be able to be put out for competition. And had that been an international company utilising an ISDS-type arbitration scheme, one can easily see how they may have sued the Scottish Government in order to win back or get back that work and continue to make profit, irrespective of the health consequences. Now, I've heard what the petitioners have said. I also welcome, so far, the commitments made that the NHS will not be included in any future trade deal. But I think it would be foolish not to recognise the concerns the public have, not to recognise how fraying around the edges with what appears to be non-core, non-clinical work can still lead to the kind of problems which are the concerns of the petitioners. So I will await with interest to hear what the Minister says, and I would simply like to end by congratulating those who signed the petition and brought this important matter before us today.
Judith Cummins.
Thank you, and it's a pleasure to serve under your chairmanship, Sir Roger. Can I congratulate my honourable friend for Hartlepool for opening this important debate and speaking so eloquently on behalf of the Petitions Committee. Can I also thank the honourable members who have contributed to this debate, including honourable friends from York Central, Coventry South, Hornsey and Wood Green, Sheffield Central, Weaver Vale, Warwick and Leamington, Bladen, Warrington South and the honourable member for South Thanet. The petition we are considering today calls on the government to categorically rule out including the NHS in future trade deals. It's been signed by more than 166,000 people, while another petition by the organisation Keep Our NHS Public has been signed by more than 500,000 people. I also note that last week the government published a summary of responses to its consultation on trade negotiations with the US, Australia and New Zealand, as well as potential accession to the CPTPP. Over 600,000 people responded, with an overwhelming number of those responses calling explicitly for protections for the NHS in trade deals. So the British public are absolutely clear. They do not want the NHS to be bargained away as part of a trade deal. They do not want companies to have the right to sue our government for decisions taken in the interests of public health. And they do not want drug prices to be pushed up by American pharmaceutical giants. And this is something we on the Labour benches firmly agree with. We are extremely proud of the Labour-created NHS, and we know how important it is to the people of the United Kingdom. We will always defend the principles of universality and it being free at the point of use. A number of honourable members, including the honourable member for Hartlepool, Coventry South, Bladen, Warrington South and Hornsey and Wood Green, mentioned the comments of the President of the United States when he said that the NHS would be on the table in any US-UK trade deal. A few hours later, perhaps after some encouragement from the current Prime Minister, he appeared to row back somewhat. But of course, on Wednesday, we are entering a brave new world with a new Prime Minister. The person almost certain to be that new Prime Minister, the Right Honourable Member for Uxbridge, has repeatedly stated that he sees concluding a quick trade deal with the US as an absolute priority. So this is a very timely debate, and one that no doubt will continue in the coming months and years. My honourable friend for Bladen made the point that the NHS cannot be part of any trade deal, and that is her red line, with my honourable friend from Warrington South speaking of our moral duty. In the time I have remaining, I want to mention a number of areas where aspects of trade deals could threaten the NHS if proper safeguards and guarantees are not put in place. I will then turn to the importance of the proper scrutiny of trade deals, both in Parliament and more generally, to ensure that no government can put our NHS in danger. The first is the risk that trade deals could increase and consolidate privatisation of the NHS. Services chapters in free trade agreements typically include provisions which lock in liberalisation measures, such as privatisation. There is genuine concern that trade agreements could force us to lock in market liberalisation of the NHS so that future governments are unable to bring these services back in-house. The move from positive lists, where only listed services are subject to liberalisation, to negative lists, where all services are deemed open to liberalisation unless explicitly excluded, makes this significantly more likely. Under the negative list system, the UK would have to explicitly opt out of all healthcare and related services. If we didn't, it would be potentially very difficult to ever bring privatised services back in-house. In my own area of Bradford, I'm currently fighting alongside Unison to stop the creation of a wholly owned company for NHS staff such as cleaners and porters. If this does go ahead, and we agree a trade deal without the correct exceptions, bringing those services back into the NHS will be even more difficult and complex. There are similar concerns about the inclusion of ISDS procedures in trade agreements. The threat of government or NHS bodies being sued under ISDS, for example, for bringing a service back in-house, can have a major chilling effect on public policy decisions. And there are numerous examples of this around the world. The Labour Party has taken a clear position on ISDS. We do not think it is necessary, and we do not think it is right. We believe there are many alternatives that balance the need for investor protection with proper guarantees so that governments can make public policy decisions without fear of corporate legal action. I'd like to turn now to the issue of drug pricing. Again, a potential deal with the US is of major concern here. Last year, President Trump accused the rest of the world of freeloading on the US, resulting in high drug prices in the US. He claimed that when foreign governments extort unreasonably low prices from US drug makers, Americans have to pay more to subsidise the enormous cost of research and development. In particular, he blamed countries that use socialised healthcare to command unfairly low prices from US drug makers. The NHS, of course, purchases drugs in significant volumes and therefore uses its bargaining power to set the price at the lowest possible levels. When the Office of the US Trade Representative published an outline of negotiating priorities for a US-UK trade deal in February, they included a section entitled Procedural Fairness for Pharmaceuticals and Medical Devices, and it stated that the US would seek standards to ensure that government regulatory reimbursement regimes are transparent, provide procedural fairness and non-discriminatory, and provide full market access for US products. So the threat here should be evident. The US Health and Human Services Secretary put it even more starkly when he said the US would pressure other countries through trade negotiations so that we pay less, they pay more. The government may say that this is not what they intend to do, but we must recognise the very real risk that in the rush to complete a trade deal with the US, this will happen, a matter of marrying in haste and repenting at leisure. In negotiations with Australia and New Zealand, the US has already tried to force changes to their medicines pricing policies. In these cases, the US backed down to achieve other trade objectives. But this is highly unlikely to be the case with the UK, given the size and scope of the NHS's purchasing power. This could lead to higher prices and less choice for the drugs the NHS needs. The effect on the NHS would be significant and potentially devastating for patients. So, as many honourable members have made clear, there are numerous and credible threats to our NHS in potential future trade agreements. That is why parliamentary scrutiny of trade agreements is so critical. We on the Labour side have repeatedly pushed for the government to bring forward an inclusive, transparent and meaningful system of scrutiny and accountability. We put forward amendments to the Trade Bill and the Lords passed Amendment 12 to the Bill, which secured the right for Parliament to vote on the mandate and have a meaningful debate on any signed deal before ratification. But alas, it seems that the Trade Bill has disappeared. So could the Minister confirm today if it will ever see the light of day again? As it must be this Parliament's right to scrutinise and approve trade deals, it is our duty to protect the NHS in trade agreements. So to finish, I'd like to thank all my honourable friends who have made it clear that we in the Labour Party will not allow our NHS to be sold off as a price for a quick trade deal. The NHS is more than a service. It is one of our proudest national institutions, and we must defend it with all that we've got. Thank you.
Minister. Well, thank you very much indeed, Sir Roger. It's a pleasure to serve under your chairmanship today, and I'd very much like to thank the member for Hartlepool for opening this debate and indeed representing the over 160,000 petitioners who put their signatures on the document. It's very, very clear that the NHS is something that all of us here and the public as a whole care very deeply about. There can be no doubt about that. We have heard it, seen it in many fora before. We know it is true. But I want to set this out right from the start, because I don't want there to be any room at all for ambiguity. I guarantee the House that the government will protect the NHS in trade negotiations. That means no requirements to increase private provision, no allowing American companies to ramp up drug prices, and no undermining safeguards on healthcare data. That is a guarantee that myself, I, the Secretary of State, and many others have repeated on many different occasions. Most recently, when I appeared at the International Trade Committee last week, I said it's the self-same thing there. The NHS is an excellent healthcare system. It tops the Commonwealth Fund's rankings for the best healthcare system in the world. More than that, it's there for all of us when we need it most. And these are not just words. Many of us, in fact, probably all of us, have an NHS story to tell, when the NHS helped them or those they love. I'm afraid my story is when the NHS couldn't be there for someone. I'm married to an American. My brother-in-law couldn't afford proper healthcare for his illness because his insurance broker made the mistake of not renewing his health insurance for 1 week. There was 1 week gap. And in that 1 week, he was diagnosed with a brain tumour and was uninsured and uninsurable. I have to say, I don't particularly want to elaborate on all that the family went through and faced for the next 3 years of his life, but it was pretty miserable. I was convinced before that it was only civilised to have the sort of system we have here in the UK, and that experience did nothing but reinforce that view. It is simply not civilised not to provide healthcare for your citizens when you can afford to do so. The US healthcare system is one where even those with insurance can never be sure if that insurance will actually pay out, where insurance policies can often be limited in extent, condemning families to penury, even if they started with quite a lot, where people with insurance routinely don't seek help at all because of the excess policies, and where those who can't afford to cover themselves are left to depend entirely on charity at best or are wholly abandoned at worst. So, as you might imagine, I want to protect the NHS, and so does this government. And I can't imagine that there could be any government in this country that would not want to do so. I have also made absolutely certain by calling both campaigns today to make absolutely 100% certain that the candidates whose names are on the ballot paper for leadership of the Conservative Party also agree with that position. Just to be 100% sure, and of course they do have that position. And even if there were a proposal to do this in due course, I think all of us in this room know that quite rightly the British people, Sir Roger, simply wouldn't have it. More than 160,000 people signed the petition we're discussing today. And only last year, a YouGov poll found that more than two-thirds of people thought the NHS was Britain's greatest achievement. Given the strength of feeling, why would this or any future government that purported to represent the people use trade deals as some kind of backdoor to privatise the NHS? It just doesn't make any sense in anybody's language. And even if they tried to do so, how would it get through Parliament? Not only could the trade deal itself not be ratified without scrutiny by Parliament, but in our constitution there is a difference, a separation between international and domestic law, so that any changes to the NHS through a trade deal would need domestic implementing legislation, not just in England, but in Scotland and in Northern Ireland and in Wales. There is no backdoor here to sidestep Parliament. So much would have to change in our domestic legislation. I cannot see any way, even if a government decided it wanted to do things this way, that it could actually happen. So the good news is that nobody has any intention of using free trade deals in this way anyway. So I simply ask that we agree today that there is no prospect whatever of any British government of any colour or flavour seeking to legislate the NHS, to privatise the NHS by the back door. Can we please put that one to bed? There are perfectly reasonable reasons to discuss issues around the NHS. That I will come on to in a moment. But please, can we stop scaremongering and pretending that any government is about to try and privatise the NHS? It is not going to happen. So what about those particulars? Well, how we protect our public services and trade deals is well known. We already have multiple layers of protection around the NHS, and indeed all our public services. The WTO's General Agreement on Trade in Services explicitly exempts services that are supplied in the exercise of governmental authority. The trade in services aspects of all agreements the UK is currently party to explicitly set out exceptions and reservations for the public for public services. And indeed, the Honourable Member for Thanet South pointed out to us that Cecilia Malmström, the Trade Commissioner for the European Union, issued letters at the time of TTIP making this absolutely crystal clear to anybody who wished to read that note, saying that you could object to any number of things about TTIP in all sorts of ways, but the one thing you could not do was pretend that this was a way for US health interests to take over publicly provided health services in the European Union. It plainly wasn't. No trade agreement has ever affected our ability to keep our public services public. No one has ever forced us to change the way we run them. As the Nuffield Trust said, and that is one of our most respected commentators on healthcare in the UK, they said a trade deal would not have the power to stop the NHS being free and universal to all. Now, a point was made a little earlier, I think, by the Honourable Member for York Central, who's no longer in her place, about Section 525 of the Health and Social Care Act. The Health and Social Care Act 2012 was not about privatisation, but about placing the financial power to change health services into the hands of those NHS professionals whom the public trust most, and putting clinicians rather than politicians in control of healthcare. The 2012 Act did not introduce competition into the NHS. Previous governments introduced competition as a core part of their earlier reforms. But what the Act did do was establish a level playing field in which any qualified provider can provide NHS-funded services to encourage a greater diversity or supply and improve patient choice. And I do ask the House to consider for a moment, where do they think NHS procurement and provision finishes and starts? Because I can't imagine a world in which we wouldn't buy our pharmaceuticals from the private sector. there is simply nobody, no government in the world, perhaps other than the Cuban government, who is actually designing pharmaceuticals? Do they suggest that if somebody's outsourcing accounting, that that is somehow a bad idea? Accounting for the NHS, how different can it honestly be? What about the building of hospitals? Do those have to be done by the NHS? What about the equipment that's used in the operating theatres? Does that have to be provided by the NHS? So I think we all know that there are areas where it makes some sense for the private sector to be involved. Now, I, like all of you, have no particular interest in seeing the provision of actual straightforward healthcare being provided by private sector providers. There are some cases where even that seems sensible, where perhaps if there isn't capacity in a certain area of expertise, then it might be right to commission outside if that capacity exists out there. But I think we can actually all agree that there are some areas around the National Health Service which will and always will be provided by the private sector because it simply makes more sense for that to happen. Investor-state dispute systems. These are mechanisms that allow foreign firms to take the UK to court for not opening the NHS to further competition. So it's said. And that, of course, is a concern, but it is not the truth. Let's be clear. ISDS, if you would forgive me, allowing me to use the acronym, does not and cannot force the privatisation of public services. The mechanisms only provide protection for established investments that companies have made in a partner's market. Now, at the end of 2017, UK businesses and investors of all sorts had around 1.3 trillion in sterling invested around the world. So these protections can be crucial, particularly where legal jurisdictions are perhaps a little less rigorous than they are here. I'll happily.
Giving way is very generous. And would he agree with me that there are precedents where companies such as tobacco companies have taken elected governments to court and wasted a whole lot of money which could have been spent on public services in private courts, and that this is a serious dent to democracy as we know it?
The Honourable Lady anticipates exactly the section I'm about to come to. If she'll just allow me a moment. So as I was saying, we've got 1.3 trillion invested overseas, but ISDS arrangements are incredibly useful for guaranteeing some delivery of justice of some sort for those who've invested under certain terms in less certain legal markets. But they cannot force the UK to change the way we run our public services. And the proof of this, and this I hope will answer her question, is in the results. The UK has more than 90 bilateral investment treaties in place, and yet there has never been a single successful ISDS claim against the UK government on any issue. Nor has the threat of potential claims affected the government's legislative programme. So I don't also believe that there is a chilling effect. The UK government has legislated exactly as it wished to do so on any issue, despite the fact we have these 90 different bilateral investment treaties. That is not to say that bringing services that have already been opened up to private providers back into public ownership might not lead to challenges. That is true, and I don't think we should sit here today and not admit that that is the case. Of course, this doesn't necessarily rely upon ISDS agreements. In the UK, we have perfectly competent courts, and I suspect that maybe many people who would pursue this actually through our regular courts and the issues of contract law. But ISDS does indeed provide another avenue. And I would say this, even the current Shadow Chancellor recognises that there would have to be compensation offered for any fairly let contracts that were not then honoured because of a change in policy. That much is absolutely clear. We have heard him say that directly. But that is wholly different from being able to force the private letting of contracts that a state wants to remain public. This cannot happen under any ISDS arrangement. So another concern that's raised its head today is, of course, on medicine costs. That a trade deal with the United States would raise the cost of medicines that the NHS needs. Across all nations of the UK, we have an excellent set of systems which generate great outcomes for patients at an affordable price. And we're proud of the way we assess the value of and agree commercial deals for medicines here in the UK, which is good for the NHS, it's good for patients, and good for companies that want to do business with us. We are absolutely clear that in any future negotiations, we could not agree to any proposals on medicines pricing or access that would put NHS finances at risk or reduce clinician and patient choice. And what on earth would the incentive be? We have a system in place that works, ensuring patients have access to medicines they need at prices that are affordable to the NHS. And that is in the best interests of patients in the UK. It's not a simply not a matter for the UK that the US is a highly fragmented market for pharmaceuticals and medical equipment, and so has reduced buying power. Neither is it a matter for any potential trade deal to contemplate this issue. There is no protectionism here. It is simply a matter of market power. Ultimately, this is a matter for US domestic politics. If they take a different route, they will have more buying power. We have taken a different route. We do have much more buying power. I can think of 1,000 different markets where the US has much larger buying power than us. Are we supposed to suddenly petition them in a US trade agreement to ask them to bargain away their buying power? I don't think so. And I don't see why it should be any difference in this case. Some, and not in this debate, but I think it's worth dealing with because there's been so much interest in this debate in terms of the numbers of signatures on the petition, some have raised the related issues of patent protection, extensions and generics. There is a complex web of interactions around these issues. On the one hand, the need to allow innovation in pharmaceutical and medical technology research, and on the other, a need to ensure that when patients expire... when patients expire. It's actually patents. Forgive me for a moment. When patents expire, that generic or biosimilar alternatives are quickly brought to market. We will seek to balance these, as we always have, in a way that stimulates research and innovation, but also the cost of supplying healthcare free at the point of use in the UK. Finally, let me turn to concerns about the potential use of NHS data. The government takes seriously the use and sharing of that data. I'd reiterate what the Secretary of State for Health and Social Care said very recently, that NHS data must always be held securely, with appropriate and strong privacy and cybersecurity protections. The government will ensure that trade negotiations do not undermine the safeguards we have in place around health and care data. These safeguards allow the public to have the trust in how and why their data is used, and it is incredibly important that we maintain these. To be clear, FTAs do have a role in data. Of course they do. We at DIT are tasked with ensuring that data flows are on a legal, safe and secure basis. We would seek to review any rules in place to safeguard data, such as data localisation requirements, and make sure they are not overly protectionist. But this should not be confused with the data that actually flows. We set up the pipework, but whether the taps are turned on or not is a matter for the regulators. In our case, that is the ICO, who are entirely clear about the need for privacy and cyber security. I'll just, if I may, Sir Roger, deal with one or two other issues that were raised during the debate that don't fit neatly into other categories in my written words. First of all, on FTA scrutiny. The Honourable Lady will know full well that we laid a command paper back earlier this year, which I think made a full and generous offer on scrutiny. I am well aware of her party's position on scrutiny, and I absolutely share with her and her front bench colleagues the need for there to be real transparency and scrutiny of free trade deals. I do absolutely understand that there aren't incentives to control every part of the passage through Parliament by votes. I would happily sit down with her at some stage and talk her through why I think that is perhaps not deliverable and perhaps not exactly what she wants. But I, too, am absolutely clear that we must have responsible scrutiny. We must have a government that is transparent as best it can be under the auspices of an FTA. When negotiating an FTA, plainly there are things you cannot reveal in public, otherwise you simply give away any negotiating advantage you might have. But at the same time, there needs to be an accountability to Parliament. So I think we are largely of a mind, at least to the principle, if not to the actual solution. On Norway and Switzerland, the Honourable Gentleman for Dundee East chose, shall we say, very carefully, the two examples he gave of Norway and of Switzerland. These, of course, are two free trade agreements that the EU has with partners who have very, very close arrangements with them in any event in other ways. And it's precisely because of those relationships they have with the European Union that they cannot match in a continuity agreement what they can match in an agreement with the EU. So the fact that those agreements are not as comprehensive as they might be are absolutely a consequence of us leaving the European Union, not as a consequence of our inability to negotiate or somehow a failure on behalf of the government. We have achieved, I think, remarkable amounts given the circumstances that both Switzerland and particularly the EEA countries face. And finally, just very briefly on positive and negative lists and ratchets and so on and so forth. In the end, having taken advice and listened to arguments from officials one way and another, I have to say
that on the whole, for me, it doesn't matter a great deal whether it's positive or whether it's negative, just that it's right. So that the outcomes, what these agreements actually achieve, are precisely what the UK wants. You can either include everything on the list and strike bits out, or you can exclude everything on the list and allow things in. But it seems to me that in the end, this is a nice distinction in the legal sense, and that actually what matters here is what the effect is when you have finished. So it's something that people talk about a great deal. In the end, all I want to do is make sure that we actually get the outputs that we need. So, Sir Roger, I hope we can agree that there is at least a slightly rosier picture now than when we started with this. The legal protections are there to give robust protection for the National Health Service. The commitment from the government is there to ensure that this remains the case. And the opportunities are there for us to make the most of our world-class experience and expertise in healthcare and the life sciences. As we look back at all the NHS has given us, particularly after its 70th birthday last year, we can be hugely proud of our past. But we can also be extremely optimistic about our future on the global stage. I'll just finally finish by repeating what I said earlier. This government, the two candidates for leadership, the previous Prime Minister, all of us on these benches, on my benches, are clear that we have no interest in privatising the National Health Service. We do not want to use free trade deals to do that either. We understand the concerns of the petitioners, and I hope very much that what I've set out today gives some reassurance.
Mike Hill to wind up.
Thank you, Sir Roger. Again, first of all, I'd like to thank the petitioners for raising this petition and for to the House of Commons Petitions Committee staff who put so much effort into advertising this petition in advance of today. Also thank members for their contributions, particularly member for Warrington South, South Thanet, Bladen, and the front bench members, and to all those who contributed via interventions. Our NHS trusts are in deficit and are creaking at the sides. NHS leaders are already over in the US of A, like NHS leaders from my local trust are looking at best practice over there. But if government reassurances are right, then the NHS will not be for sale. But again, as the petitioners say quite rightly, words are not enough. We need the right checks and balances to protect us from trade agreements and marketisation. And ultimately, we need to, as members have said, consider revoking the Health and Social Care Act of 2012 in order to protect those services that thus far have been privatised already. Thank you, Sir Roger.
This House has considered e-petition 242300 relating to the future trade deals and the National Health Service. As men of that opinion say aye.
Aye.
Don't you know? The ayes have it. Order.